praise the Lord. It is good to be in the house of the Lord on a sweltering Sunday morning. Everybody hopefully has access to air conditioning today. Pretty excited, pretty worked up. Roberto started writing a song and shared it with us Wednesday. And so I really feel like these songs that are going to come forth from this house are warfare. And so just keep us in prayer as you enter your daily devotions. Just remember the worship team, remember the house of prayer that we've established here, and that the word will come for us. So I'm pretty excited. Some good stuff's coming. Okay, I'll just wait and let you guys see the final product. But, you know, it's funny because Wednesday I shared a story that, you know, Tammy always says, what is hidden must come to light. And my husband had lost the Wi-Fi codes, which is a big deal in our house. And so I told him, and my dad was like, well, are they here? Are they there? Because my dad has to have Facebook. And and I said, just stop. The word says all things hidden must come to light. And Michael's like, whatever. And I'm like, stop. Say it out loud. Whatever. Just humor me, okay? I'm not going to stop, so just humor me. Fine, all things hidden must come to light. I'm like, okay, now go get them. But no, they're found. Just go get them. And he runs upstairs and starts looking at him. He's like, found them. Like, of course you did. Why wouldn't you? And, you know, as we talked about Wednesday, that's how it is in all things. It's a small little thing. And, of course, this morning I lose my keys, right? Because why wouldn't I? And I'm running around the house. I'm digging through the garbage. I'm like, what am I doing? Stop. All things hidden must come to light. And I go, and I knew they were in my purse. I swear I emptied my purse twice already, and I just took it and I shook it upside down, and what falls out but my keys? I'm looking in the scriptures, right? Yes. I'm looking in the scriptures for what I need. All things hidden must come to light. When, you know, I feel like I know what this song is supposed to say. I feel like I know what these verses are going. All things hidden must come to light. I have a lack or I have need in my life. I have a pain or an ache in my body. What is hidden must come to light. My healing must come to light. Yes. I am the living word. Yes. I am one with the living word. Yes. I am the word of God. Yes. I am the living, breathing, speaking word of God. Yes. All things that are hidden come to light. Yes. And Jason was talking to me after the service last Sunday, and I didn't finish one of the passages of scripture that I meant to. I didn't flip the screen and just kept going or something. And where Jesus was in the temple reading about himself, the end of that passage says, and this day the scripture has been fulfilled. Yes. And Jason's like, I thought you were going there. God's been telling me to speak that. God's been telling me every time I pray the word of God to say, this day this scripture is fulfilled. And that's powerful, Jason. Yes. I've been praying about that all week, and it is so right on. Yes. Yeah. Amen.
And he said, if you're ever sick, you find something in the Bible that says, by your stripes I'm healed. And this day, this scripture is fulfilled.
All right. Yes. That's right.
And amen.
Finances.
Amen.
You find something in the Bible that has finances. And then after you read it, you pray about it, and say, in this day, this scripture is fulfilled.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And those scriptures must come to light.
Yes.
When we call on it, when we call on the word, he will reveal the word, the rhema, the now word.
Amen.
The living word. And it is fulfilled the moment we speak it.
Yes.
It is fulfilled. The moment the words come out of our mouth. And if we need to hear it this day, right now, this word is fulfilled.
Yes.
Oh,
amen.
Jesus, he has done it all.
Yes.
He has done it all.
Yes.
Can he make it any easier for us? I make it awfully hard for myself, but he has made it so, so easy for us.
Amen.
To just believe and trust in him and watch as he gets all the glory.
Hallelujah.
As we walk around so blessed, people are going, I know them. Why, what is going on? How on earth? It's not of this earth, right? So I just encourage you guys, just shed the light.
Yes.
Ask and receive, knowing that our Father gives good gifts. Amen. Anybody else have anything or any prayer requests? Yes.
So when you start talking about
Lord, yeah, Mike.
Well, he was talking about that the Lord impressed upon me about the parable of the widow with the two mites, giving more than those that had many riches and stuff. Many of us think that we don't have gifts, that we don't have discernment from the Lord, that the knowledge of the Lord is not working through us and things. The mites that we have in our lives and in our spirit is what he's asking for. It may be only, as Roberto was talking about in a song, there might be only one line of one verse. So that is a mite. And as those things are put together, this is the tapestry that I believe that the Lord is putting here at this time. So it takes all, even those in the congregation, there are things that the Lord is putting on your heart. And the words that you speak reflect what is going on in the spirit realm need to be spoken out so they can be combined into what the Lord is doing here.
Yeah.
So turn your might, M-I-T-E, into might, M-I-G-H-T.
Amen.
In the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Jason.
I'd like to say a prayer for my brother and his friend there in Haiti, and they're preaching the word down there. I just hope it's God's word and those people down there get what they really need.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah. Anybody else have any needs or any? Yeah, Mike.
Pray for Cindy's situation with her computer. The computer she does all the processing for on. The website and stuff here and everything else. We took off Friday night, came back, and between then and now, the hard drive decided to go down. It's not so much the replacing the hard drive, it's the information that's on there that she can't get off. She needs to get off these programs and stuff like that. So pray for discernment, wisdom, and a path and a door for this to get taken care of.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah.
I just
want
to
pray
for peace and boldness for this
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Amen.
Dive in again. The kingdom that the Lord has revealed here, we are to take to the north, south, and east, and the west, and we understand that. All I can do is live the life where I work, and there's a gentleman who's been off for about 10 weeks. His name's Stormy. I believe it's a spirit of depression that's on his life. He didn't get his name by accident. This guy is about 450 pounds, about 6'3". He's strong as an ox, but he's as tender as a teddy bear. But he doesn't know the Lord, he knows of the Lord, and he came in to get insurance papers Friday, and he went and got the papers and stuff like that, asked him how he's doing and stuff like that, and we're talking about medication and all stuff kind of stuff, and I just discerned the spirit of pharma all over him and stuff, and just said a quiet prayer before he left, and he went on out, then he turned around. And there's nobody else up the front counter area. And he said, Mike, you got a second? And I walked up to the counter, and he comes and talked to me, and with tears rolling up his eyes, he says, my sister's been diagnosed with lung cancer. Her name is Shirley. I know you pray and stuff like that. Could you pray for her? So I'm going to lift up Shirley right now and bind the cancer off her life, lung cancer off her life, but also to challenge Stormy right now where he is at and pull him up out of the depths where he is at to arise in the kingdom purposes and plans and so.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, anybody else? All right, well, let's stand and go to the Lord this morning. Heavenly Father, we just
praise
come before this morning.
Thank you, Jesus. Lord, we celebrate the victory in every one of these situations and circumstances. We know, Lord, it is finished in your name. We
praise
you. Finished work of God right now.
Thank you that by your stripes, Lord, we are healed. On this day, that scripture is fulfilled, Lord.
Revelation in every area. We bless your name right now and praise you. Thank you, Lord.
In your name, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord, for victory. For making us more than prosperous. Thank you for that every good gift comes from you. Thank you, Jesus. We bless your name right now. You are great. You are great. There's nothing. Lord, for the work you have laid at this house.
thank you, Lord, that you are faithful, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you will fulfill the promises that you have laid in our hearts, Lord Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that your word is a rock upon which we can stand, Lord, unfailing, Lord. We thank you for the victory that comes every time we put our hope and our trust in you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you have chosen to bless us to display your glory to this world, Lord. We thank you that your loving kindness overtakes us when we allow it, Lord, when we lay aside our fear and our doubt, Lord. That your love overtakes us, Lord, your peace, Lord, your joy uplifts us, upholds us, Lord, as we look with these earthly eyes, Lord, and watch as your glory covers this earth, Lord. Oh, Jesus, in this age, in this time, Lord, as this age draws to a close, Lord, as this earth starts to fade away, Lord, I thank you, Lord, that with our eyes we will see your glory cover this earth. I thank you that it is our mouths that speak your truth, that loose your holy power in this world, Lord. We thank you for the lives pulled from hell, Lord, from the depths of hell, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for our loved ones who turn and serve you, Lord, that they fulfill the callings on their lives, Lord. Jesus, I thank you that what you have begun, you will bring to fruition, Lord. You will complete it in perfection, Lord. And we come together this day to lift you up and magnify you, to rejoice in your holy place, Lord, in your presence, Lord, that you are worthy, Lord. You are worthy. And we praise you this day in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. All right, let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Yes, Lord. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. Yes, Lord. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine. Yes, Lord. Yes, hallelujah. John and Toby, you guys want to come take the offering this morning? Toby, you want to ask the blessing?
You haven't seen the Father of Light yet. It's been going around pretty good. A lot of people have seen it. Everyone.
Y'all seen it?
All right.
Hallelujah.
Woo! Y'all ready to worship?
Yes.
Amen.
I heard about two of you. Y'all ready to worship?
Yeah.
Woo! Glory to the Lord. Lord, this song's been on my heart for about 3 weeks now, and pastor's been speaking. Every time he speaks, he says, man, these guys got to learn how to do this song. Got to learn how to do this song. Well, Suzanne, God be with you, girl.
I'm about ready to learn it.
In the 60s, we would call it a magic carpet ride, so just hang on to the tail end of it, and we'll go from there. Majestic is your name, your words are true, and your mercy is not changed.
Thank you. I was like,
my fault.
Praise the Lord.
A little too high. Let's try it in the right key.
Is
two, three, four. All that stuff I smell in the atmosphere. kind of remind me of Texas, even though I've never been there. The corn dogs.
Thank you.
voice, church, and worship Him. He is worthy. Lift your voice, church. Lift your voice. Lift your voice. The sound of many waters. The sound of many waters. The sound of many waters. Lift your voice, church.
time you call on the name of the Lord. He is Savior. Amen. And it means more than just escaping hell. It means sozo, and that means everything completed, everything fulfilled, everything is made new, no lack. Amen. When we call on the name of the Lord, we're calling on salvation every time. And that salvation heals our body. Amen. It causes whatever we set our hand to prosper. Amen. It causes our words to have power when we speak in agreement with that Savior. It changes the environment. It puts us in another realm. Amen. The realm of the miraculous. That's where we are created for, church. And it's all around us. We don't have to go off into heaven. We don't have to escape this realm, the natural realm, to have the supernatural released. It's why we're in this realm, so that we can bring the other realm here. Amen. The reality is the unseen. Praise God. What we see is temporary. We know that it is because it changes all the time. It's constantly in flux. But the real world, the supernatural world, the miraculous realm, is always the same. Healing always happens there. Prosperity always happens there. Lives are transformed there. God is revealed there. Hallelujah. I feel like we've touched that realm this morning. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's not let it go away.
That's right.
Let's keep it. It comes from within us. Hallelujah. It's not coming from some distant planet somewhere. It's coming right out of here. Out of your belly flows rivers of living water. Spiritual, amen, sustenance for whatever the need may be. Amen. Let's call on the name of the Lord right now. Jesus, we bless you. We praise you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus, we worship you. We exalt you. We magnify you. Oh, we love that name. The name above every name. The name by which we are called. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Hallelujah. Let eternity glorify you, Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Let all of your creation praise you and exalt you and glorify you. Praise God. Praise God. Give him a big hand clap this morning. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Amen. Thank you again, worship team. Appreciate it so much. You're being sensitive to the Holy Ghost. Amen. And I want to also thank Suzanne for standing in last week and delivering a great message and being a blessing. Praise the Lord. I appreciate that. While we were down on the Lake of the Ozarks, praise the Lord. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Amen. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. We can agree with that. Amen. Praise God. Anyway, praise the Lord. Thank you very much. And we were glad to be able to get away for a weekend and spend some time with my daughter and her husband and float around on the water for a little bit. Hallelujah. Eat a whole lot. And then sink if we got back in the water, so we didn't get back in. But praise the Lord. We had a good time, and I appreciate the people here stepping up and allowing us that opportunity to be able to get away from time to time. Amen. You know, it's an old saying that laugh and the whole world laughs with you. Snore and you sleep alone. Lighten things up a little bit. Hallelujah. Yeah, you can write that down. You can quote me on that. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, hallelujah. We want to get into the Word of God this morning, but I just wanted to say that, you know, Wednesday night we were talking about something I think is really profound, and it's a simple truth, but it's profound as much of the Bible is, that we are the will of God. We are begotten of God. We're not just saved from hell. We are the desire of God to be born again. And the scripture says that by his will he brought us forth. He begot us. So you're not an accident. You know, we are what God wants us to be, his children. And whenever we get, if ever we can totally grasp this, there's no limit to what we can do. Because if we're begotten of God, we are as God. That's what the Bible teaches. We are heirs and joint heirs with Christ. There is no limit to what we can do if we ever settle this once and for all and realize God is with me all the time. He'll never leave me or forsake me. We talk about, you know, well, you can, he holds us in the palm of his hand, but you can jump out. No, you can't. Not if you're born again, any more than you can jump in before you were born again. He has us, and he's not going to let us go. And he has us for a reason, and that reason is to glorify him, to reveal him. It takes supernatural to reveal God. You can't reveal God just by being a nice person. We should be nice people, but that doesn't reveal God. What reveals God is the supernatural. What reveals God is for things to happen that otherwise cannot happen, and the world knows it. Yep. Praise the Lord. So we need to, our thinking needs to change, and I mean that's why the Bible tells us that we have to have our minds renewed. And I said Wednesday night, I think it was Wednesday night or the Wednesday night before, that the church has been in in this state of, I'll say it this way, it's not a real word, but it is after I say it, an unwise world, an unwise time. The church has been unwise. And that's what the Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 3. You don't have to go there, but just briefly, I want you to know that scripturally speaking, it tells us that the church is not operating in wisdom. We are operating in knowledge, but not wisdom. Wisdom comes from God. Knowledge we can get. You can get knowledge by learning. You know, you know this. You turn on the Christian stations, you listen to theologians and people with degrees, you know, like a thermometer, but they have no wisdom. They can tell you information, but they can't give you the wisdom of God. They can't give you the supernatural because they don't really believe it. They don't really grasp it. Amen? So the unwise church era, I believe, is the period that we have lived in. But it's what is coming to an end. It's what God is bringing revelation and awakening. You know, in Matthew chapter 25, it talks about these virgins, these 10 virgins. And when you read that, you have to realize that these virgins are not the church. They are the bridesmaids of the church. The church is the bride. These are bridesmaids. They're not the church, amen? They didn't have oil in their lamps, and they didn't ask the Spirit to guide them. That's wisdom. Wisdom is when God leads. Wisdom is when God directs our path. Amen? They had the wisdom of the world. They had intellect. They had natural light and natural knowledge, amen? But they didn't seek the wisdom of God. In other words, they didn't seek after the Spirit, what God is doing, amen? So they were foolish. They had every opportunity, but they didn't take advantage of it. Praise God. Sense knowledge comes from experiments and experiences. You touch a hot stove, you had an experience. you know, now that's hot. Don't touch it again. You can experiment with things to try to get answers or get results. And that's what sense knowledge is, but it's never perfect. It's not perfect because there's always this element of limitation. There's always chances for mistakes because it's done by the senses. And our senses don't always tell us the truth. Amen? They just report back facts, sense facts. Amen? So the word that Paul uses in his prayer, where he prays that we would have all the fullness of the knowledge of God and the wisdom of God in Christ, the word that he actually uses there is translated precise knowledge or full knowledge. Or another way you could say it, wisdom. So Paul prays that we be filled with the exact, precise, the full knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. Praise the Lord. Now that's just kind of a recap of what we were talking about the last couple of weeks. But when I was in another organization, a lifetime ago it seems like, and sometimes it was yesterday, the Lord. But I used to teach a Bible study and on the tabernacle, the plan of the tabernacle. Some of you all probably have seen that or maybe even taught it yourselves. There's a lot of intricacies. It covers everything. Everything from the little loops that they hung the curtains on to, you know, the outer court, the inner court, and the Holy of Holies, and so on and so forth. It's all fascinating, and it's all true, how it points to Christ. But God has been showing me something recently, too, because, you know, there's always layers of everything in the Word of God. I mean, you know, when you first read something, you read it, and you go, yeah, got it. And then you come back 5 years later, and all of a sudden you're seeing something else and something. Not that the first thing goes away and is no longer true. It's just that you're seeing other things beyond that. And that's the way the Word of God always works. But what I've been seeing is that when we look at that, just the basic of the tabernacle, you have the outer court, which is for anybody can come in there. And then you have the inner court, which is just for the priests, plural, where they minister the lamp, you know, the menorah, the table of shewbread, and the altar of incense. And then you have the Holy of Holies, where only the high priest could go in once a year and bring the blood of the atonement, the sacrifice, and sprinkle the mercy seat. So the outer court, you have natural light. It's open. It's an open space. And it's all physical work. Mm-hmm. It's butchering animals and throwing them on a thing. I mean, I understand the spiritual ramifications of it, but it's physical stuff. It's all natural. And then you come into the inner court, you have a soul or intellect take over. Now, it's still physical, but there are religious connotations to what they're doing. But they're still doing stuff. They still have to light the candle. They still have to offer the incense. They still have to eat the showbread, which represents the Word of God. The candelabra represents revelation or light, but it's artificial light. It's something a little bit beyond natural light, but it's artificial. And our prayers, I'm not suggesting that we shouldn't pray. I'm saying that our prayers are still human endeavor. You know, unless you're praying in tongues, you're praying with your natural mind, which is subject to your senses. And the shewbread is the Word of God. Well, if you read the Word of God, natural light or artificial light, it's still just words on a page. It's true, but it's just a natural truth, which is why religions always end up trying to do this stuff without the Spirit. They think it's a rule book for behavior, and obviously that's what the Jews thought, rather than a revelation of God and us as well. But then you have the Holy of Holies, which is all spirit.
Yeah.
It's lit by the Shekinah glory of God. There was no light in there, and the priest did not bring a light in there with him. And in fact, the tradition is they tied a rope around his ankle, and if he wasn't totally absolved of any sin, if there was anything going on in his life, they say that they would keep. I read a book by Eiderschein one time, who was a Hebrew scholar, and he said that they would keep them up all night long, so they wouldn't be the possibility of them having a dream that might be perverse or unholy. So they keep him awake all night, and they, you know, he had to, like the scripture tells us, you know, what good is it, even if I would die for a good person, who's going to sacrifice for me? If I sacrifice for them, you know what I mean? It just doesn't work that way. So they would tie a rope around his ankle, and if he went in, and if there was anything, he'd drop over dead, and they'd have to drag him out. So the Holy of Holies is all spirit. That's where God wants us to be. He doesn't, the outer court, all that work, all those sacrifices, they're all great, but that isn't where he wants us. We think, oh, well, we've graduated, now we're in here where we're ministering. He doesn't even want us there. The whole idea is to get us behind that veil where it's all God, where we have to walk in his light, because artificial light won't cut it, natural light won't do it. You have to have the light of God. That's, I think, what God is doing in this last day. That's where the message of grace and all this comes from. Jesus, you know, we think of, well, you know, I was a horrible sinner. I am a terrible sinner, whatever. And then Jesus took my sins and became sin. But in fact, Jesus never sinned. He was as innocent hanging on that cross as he was when he was birthed from Mary's womb. He just took the punishment for all that sin. Otherwise, he wouldn't have been God. Something would have happened. The sin separated him from God. But he didn't sin. He just took the punishment. He was just exactly, on a perfect scale, what that little lamb was that they brought in. The lamb never did anything, and he never did sin, no matter how much they laid their hands on him and transferred their shame and their guilt. The lamb was still innocent. He just had to die, because the person who was laying their hand on him wasn't innocent. That's why they inspected the lamb. They didn't inspect the person, because they knew they were full of sin. They had all kinds of problems, or they wouldn't be bringing the lamb. They inspect the lamb to make sure it's perfect. So don't allow yourself to be confused to think that Jesus became like you. Jesus just received what you deserved so that you can have what Jesus deserved. And then God looks at you like he looks at Jesus, because that sacrifice was perfect. Amen. That's why the high priest would go in once a year. And when that was done, they had a party like it was 1999. They partied. Why? Because let's celebrate. All of our sins are forgiven. Tell the next one, but right now, I mean, I'm talking about in the end of that dispensation. It was party time, and God told them, eat the fat, drink the wine, celebrate. There's no condemnation for you. There's not going to be any punishment. Man, you ought to be happy. You ought to be just having a great time. Amen? So we need to understand that God is trying to get us someplace, and it's to a place of perfection. Not in us, but in him. And we keep wandering around out here in the outer court and in the inner court thinking this is ministry, this is Christianity, when in fact, Christianity is behind that veil. That's why Jesus came to rent the veil, so that we could come directly into the presence of God and not have to deal with all that stuff anymore. All those things pointed to how you get behind that veil. But once you get behind the veil, you don't need all the stuff anymore. Amen. It has put you in the presence of what all that stuff represented. That's where we want to be. That's where religion has failed us. It keeps dragging us by the leg back into the holy place or back into the outer court. When God wants us to stay in the Holy of Holies, where the mercy of God prevails. where the only light is the light of God. It's not intellect, it's not information, it's not religion, it's just God and you. Praise the Lord. So with that, let's begin this morning with Philippians chapter 2 and verse 13. Praise the Lord. Everybody say, talk to me, Jesus. Hallelujah. And that won't be me. That won't be the voice you're hearing. But he can speak to your heart. Amen. For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. It's God that's in you both to will and to do his good pleasure. So he wills for it to be done, and then he does it in you. Amen. All right, James chapter 1 and verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given to him. Praise God. So we have the power within us, willing and working his own pleasure. It's working in you right now, right this moment, every moment of your life, it's happening. We have the Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead. Do you realize that? Right here in front of you, you can't see it, but in me is the very Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead. Oh, hallelujah. That ought to give you goosebumps or make you, because you got it too. If you're born again, you have residing in you, never going to leave you, the very Spirit that raised up Christ from the dead and who will also quicken your mortal body, amen, in the rapture. Dead or alive? You're going to be changed, dead or alive. Praise God. See, we've been governed by experiences. Even when it's supernatural experiences, even when it's church experiences, we've been governed by them. And generally, we believe that the power is going to come if we have a certain kind of experience. Now, if I'm not talking about you, I said generally. But you know what I mean? That's just kind of the way we think, that if I have a certain kind of experience, then God's going to move. There's going to be a move of God. There's going to be something supernatural is going to take place. So we seek for that experience. That's why we imitate past experiences, thinking that it will somehow generate a move of God or a supernatural experience. Yeah. It's all about the experience. You know what I mean? That's what we do. We end up having more confidence in the experiences that other people have than in the Word of God, which is why we go to certain preachers or certain meetings or whatever. I'm not saying any of that's wrong. I'm just saying we're looking for that person's experience to affect me. I want that experience, you know. I want their experience. And I know this offends people sometimes because everybody's got their favorite ministries, which is all cool, and I'm not trying to belittle that. I'm just saying, this is the human mind. This is the way we operate. Yeah. We are sense-focused, even though we are spirit beings. Yeah. So we're looking for experiences because we want to have an experience, right? Yeah. So we end up then looking at other people's experiences, trying to define what kind of an experience I should have. Does that make sense? Yeah. That's not what God's trying to get us to understand. That's not what he's trying to get us to do. In 1 Corinthians, let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 30. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Look at this now. Of him are ye in Christ, who of God is made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. All right? The ability and wisdom that Jesus used in his earthly human life is ours. It's not going to be. We're not hoping someday for it to be. It is. Praise the Lord. See, the devil loves to make us conscious of our unworthiness, our experiences, instead of looking at the Word of God. Praise God. All right, Romans chapter 3, verse 26. We're going to have a lot of scriptures today because I want you to see this from the Word of God. Romans chapter 3, verse 26. To declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. To declare, yeah, at this time, his righteousness, yeah, that he might be just and the justifier of whoever believes. So righteousness, we look at that word, and most of us haven't had a definite interpretation of righteousness. We know the word. I mean, we repeat the word, we read the word, but we don't really have a definitive kind of understanding of it. We've been taught to believe that right conduct, right living is what righteousness is. That was a righteous act, you know? But Paul's teaching us that the word righteousness means the ability to stand in the presence of God. The word that Paul's using here is the word that says, step through the veil. Come on out of the holy place into the holy of holies. You don't need to be there anymore. It's not anymore about what you're doing. It's about where you are. It's your position. Amen? Righteousness is being able to stand in the presence of God without any sense of guilt, without any sense of fear, without any sense of condemnation. To be able to literally, boldly come into the presence of God. Now, we've been taught that that's arrogance and that's foolishness and you'll die. No, not if you're a child of God. The people that fall on their face and freak out are the people who don't have God in them. Now, I'm not saying if we had a quote-unquote great manifestation of God that it wouldn't freak us out, because we're still in the flesh. But God's not asking for us to fall down and freak out. He's asking us to come right in. We don't have to be intimidated. We don't have to feel like, oh, God, you know, I'm such a bad person. I know what I deserve and to be in your presence. No, his presence is in me all the time. He wants us to come boldly as though we deserve to be in his presence. Anything less than that is actually a mockery of what Jesus did, of what God did in the flesh. He either did a complete and a finished work, or he didn't. And for us to act fearful and you know, alienated from God somehow, denies what he's done. Yep. Amen? You see what I mean? I'm not talking about pride, human arrogance, or anything. I'm just saying, I know what God has said. I believe what God has said. Therefore, here I am. Yep. Praise the Lord. And it also gives us the ability to come into the presence of Satan without any sense of inferiority or fear. So when Satan shows up, Jesus wasn't freaking out. He just spoke the word. He called the demons out, cast them out, run them off. I saw Satan. I know where he is. I know where he was, and I know where he is. He fell like lightning. This wasn't a little thump. This wasn't a, you know, trying to hang on and slid down a slippery slope. No, he got the boot from God, and he went flying out of there, amen, like a comet, like a streak of light, and didn't stop till he hit the earth. And we are as God. We are begotten of God. We are the will of God. Satan freaks out every time a believer stands up and, like we heard this morning, amen, command cancer to go. Curse the cancer. Yes. Amen. Declare in agreement with the Word of God. He has no defense for that. Amen. He's fighting God when he comes against you. And I don't know, any of you know that whenever you've had a supernatural experience, you were bold as a lion. I mean, when that rises up in you, you've got the, you know, I don't care what it is, cancer, I don't care if it's financial, I don't care what it is, you'll just start talking like you were God himself. Devil, I'm telling you, get out of my house. Don't ever show your face around here again. You're not welcome here. Hallelujah. You are under my feet. And come back, I'll prove it. You'll be looking at the soles of my feet. They'll be wiping the tread marks of my shoes off of your back. Amen? We say, oh, my God, you don't want to offend the devil. Hey, he's got nothing on me. He has no standing in heaven. He can't. He is a liar. He cannot. Anything that he says against me is absolutely worthless. Jesus has declared me righteous. Praise the Lord. So how do I get this righteousness? Romans chapter 3, verse 26 again. I declare, I say at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of them that believe. He's justified me. He's declared me righteous. Amen? 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now, I know that's just verbiage. Sometimes we look at it and it's just words on a page. But let me tell you something. That is so powerful. It's almost more than I can get my mind around. I have become the righteousness of God. The righteousness of God. Not just a really righteous person. Not just a really good, you know, behaving individual. The righteousness of God. I'm talking perfection. He tells us that we are what he has perfected. How? By making us the righteousness of God in Christ. I mean, I'm saying, if you understand that, the lies of the devil will fall off you like water off a duck's back. He's got nothing in you. He's got no more in you than he had in Jesus. He cannot touch who you are. He has to deal with your mind. He has to get you to cooperate with his way of thinking. Praise the Lord. God himself has become our righteousness. The moment you got born again. All right? Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20. Because I'm talking about, these are fundamental things, but I'm talking about it so we can do church. Not just do religion and not just do a service, but do, you know, be the church. Now unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. He does exceeding abundantly above what my mind can think by what's already in me. Praise God. According to the power that's working in you. That is the will and the pleasure of God. See, God's ability is at work in you right now. You have grace given to you according to the measure of the gift of Christ. The fullness. So that the very ability and grace of God is yours. Now that's profound. The very ability of God, amen, and the grace of God is yours. If there's weeping in heaven, it's going to be because we'll find out this ability that we never operate in, but we had it all along. This isn't made up. This isn't my opinion. This is the Bible. This is what God has laid out here for us. And this is what this world, the natural earth, and everybody on it is crying out for. Even us, even our own natural man is crying out for the reality of what is in us. This witness that we haven't been able to quite make the connection with. Amen. That always makes us feel like it's just around the next corner. Right. The next revival, the next ministry. And it's as has already been said here today. This scripture is read in your hearing. It is a now reality. It's not something that's coming. It is a right now thing. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Praise God. Okay, John chapter 1 and verse 16. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. Another translation, and of his fullness have all we received, and grace upon grace. Praise God. Of his fullness have all we received. Praise God. All right, James chapter 5. Verse 13 and 18. See, we have to start looking at these things. It's real. It's not just about somebody else. It's not just a hope, a dream. It's God defining us. He's describing us. Praise God. James 5:13 through 18. Now, I want to show you something here. And while Roberto's pulling that up, let me read this to you, just a brief thing out of the Message Bible. This is the kind of the synopsis of the gospel. Just, you know how the beginning and some Bibles, they'll have a little historical kind of account of what's going on at the time. This is just one paragraph out of this for the book of James. And it says, the letter of James shows one of the church's early pastors skillfully going about his work of confronting, diagnosing, and dealing with areas of misbelief and misbehavior. Now, we're not talking about sin. We're talking about acting on the knowledge that they had. And so, and had turned up, these things that had turned up in a congregation committed to his care. Deep and living wisdom is on display here. Wisdom both rare and essential. Wisdom is not primarily knowing the truth, although it certainly includes that. It is skill in living. For what good is a truth if we don't know how to live it or use it? Amen. What good is an intention if we can't sustain it? And I would say that's a definition of the church. I mean, that's a picture of where we've been. So James says here, beginning of verse 13, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. And remember what the context in which we just read this. This is being written. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elijah was a man subject to passion, like passion as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Now, James is talking about, because he's talking about Elijah didn't have the Holy Ghost. The Spirit of God moved on those prophets at that time. And look at the kind of power that prevailed. Now, we have this Spirit in us, this resurrection power, this fullness of God, this ability of God living within us. Amen? So James is telling these since experience ruled people, believers, how to get their healing. These are sense ruled believers. That's the way, the context in which he's presenting this. All right? But Peter tells us in 1 Peter 2:24 that believers are already healed. Right? By his stripes you were healed. So James is talking to those people who are walking by sight, by feelings, by what they hear, the doctor's report, the prayer that's prayed over them. I mean, I'm telling you have to look at this in the context in which he's writing it. They have to have the elders come and pray for them. They have to have their prayers. They have to feel the elders' hands laying on them. And then they believe. Now, that's not wrong. That's not, it's not that we can't do that. I'm saying we need to understand who that's for. That's for the believer who is operating in the senses. They got to feel something. They got to see something. They got to see somebody that they think is more spiritual than them, that has a more, you know, intimate relationship or something, which is all bogus, but that's what they think. So that's what he's saying. If that's what we got to do, that's what we got to do. If that's where your faith is, we'll operate where your faith is. But Peter's talking to believers, amen, who are just healed simply because they realize it's already done. They didn't have to go get the preacher. They didn't have to go get the, you know, the guy that's prayed up down at the end of the block. They just got together in their living room and said, by his stripes we're healed, bless God, and we're going to believe that and confess that until everybody else comes into agreement with it. I'll pray for anybody, don't get me wrong, but I'm saying that's the lower level. That's for the beginning believer. All right, James chapter 1, verse 5 through 7. Praise the Lord. Do you see what I'm saying? I'm not trying to belittle praying for people. I'm saying if we operate as... you ever see Jesus have anybody pray for him? Was he not tired? Did he not hunger? Was he not subject to all the same pains and aches and everything that every other human being has? But yet he never had anybody pray for him, not even the whole group of apostles. Not even just to make him feel good. Why? Because he knew he was healed. He knew that he was fed. He knew that he was prospered. He knew because of the relationship that he had with the Father. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given unto him. But let him ask in faith. Nothing wavering, for he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think he shall receive anything of the Lord. He's not talking to a believer who has entered into his inheritance. He's talking to somebody who's not sure. Will God do it or won't God do it? It's a believer, but it's just a believer who's not settled. Who isn't sure of his inheritance. Who doesn't maybe understand what his inheritance is based on. Because if otherwise, that doesn't fit with Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 3. Let's look at that. And there's not any contradictions in the Bible. It's just a misunderstanding, the way that we're interpreting. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. That's everything. That's everything heaven has to offer has already been blessed. We've already been blessed with it. Now, if that's true, then the people that understand this are not the same people, even though they're all believers, as the people James is talking to, amen, when he says, look, if you're going to ask God for something, you better believe that what you're asking for you have, or else you're like a wave on the ocean. You're double-minded, and you're not going to get it. Why? Because you've already got it and don't know it. Praise the Lord. That's the believer who has entered into all of their privileges. It's walking in the fullness of the wisdom of Christ. James is talking to people who are walking in sense knowledge. Even though they're believers, they still operate from their senses. They still operate by what they feel. They still operate by what they see. They're going to heaven, but they're not going to reveal much of God in this earth. Because they're still begging. They're still looking for somebody to pray for them. They're still looking for somebody to say the right thing to them instead of depending on the Spirit of God that's in them that's already done it all. They're double-minded. On the one hand, they believe God, but on the other hand, they need man to somehow promote what God has done. Look, I'm not trying to, you know, belittle preachers or ministers or anything else. I'm just saying, look, if the church doesn't grow up and realize its identity, if it doesn't ever get into its understanding of its inheritance, we're going to be playing the same religious game 1,000 years from now. Jesus is coming back for a church that has made herself ready. Now, that doesn't mean we're doing good stuff to get Jesus to come back. It means that we've put ourselves in a position to where God can be revealed, where we can be raised up and Christ can descend. In us and through us. These people's faith rises and falls. We read 2 or 3 scriptures here. Wisdom belongs to the believer. Now, understand what I'm saying. The problem is not faith. Jesus tried to explain this before the Spirit had ever been poured out. The problem is not faith. We've made it about faith. We've got whole movements that are about faith. I'm not saying we don't have faith. I'm just saying that is not the problem. Having no sense of righteousness, trying to experience faith, or exercise faith, I should say, for wisdom. Not having a sense of righteousness, not having a sense of being totally accepted, perfect in God, with the ability of God. Amen. Trying to exercise faith for wisdom. When what belongs to us requires absolutely no faith. Think about it. If you've got it, you don't need faith for it. Right? You've already got it. We're trying to figure out some way to increase faith so that we can get what's already ours, what we already have, what we already possess. That's what Jesus was trying to say. Faith, he'd already breathed on them, empowered them to heal the sick, cast out demons, and all of that. They didn't have the Holy Spirit, but they had the ability, they had the power and the anointing on them in order to do those things, or he wouldn't have sent them out to do it. And that's why he was baffled by it. They're saying, well, increase our faith. He said, it's already yours. Didn't I tell you to do this? I wouldn't have told you to do it if you couldn't do it. It's not about faith. It doesn't take faith for what you've already got. It takes believing. Yes. Just believe that you've got it. Yes. See, not realizing grace and the riches of it that are already ours. Blessed with every spiritual blessing, but not knowing it. Reading it, but not really believing it. You don't need faith for what you already possess. Let the carnal pray. Let them pray for faith. Let the sense knowledge people pray for faith. Because you that are mature don't need to. Jesus is your faith. Yes. Yes. He has become unto you faith, righteousness. Amen. He was made unto you faith. Yes. You don't need faith. See, grace covers everything. Yes. He is your faith. He is the faith that you got to have. Yes. Or you think you have to have. He was made. Just as he was made sin, he was made faith. John 1:16 again. Of his fullness. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace upon grace. Unlimited. No end to it. You've received his fullness. Praise the Lord. Whether you've enjoyed what you've received isn't the problem. You still received it. The problem is to learn and to take your place as a son of God and enjoy the fullness and the riches of His grace. That covers everything. All right, Revelation chapter 3, verse 14, we'll read right on down through 22. This is what I was saying at the very beginning, what's happening with the church, and has. Under the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful, true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest that not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also have overcome, or overcame, and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. That's the picture of the church without wisdom.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30. That's an end-time church, by the way. It isn't like he's cut them off. He's just identifying the way they operate. Lacking wisdom. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Jesus was made unto the church wisdom. But for most churches, for the most part, the church too, has gloried in sense knowledge. We promote it. We perpetuate it with our very kind of apparatuses, if you will, for revival and special meetings and all this stuff. That's for sinners. And we spend all our time resaving the saved and trying to heal the healed and trying to prosper the prosperous instead of teaching them what they are and who they are and what they have and focusing on that. Look, if you're broke, you're not helping somebody else that's broke. You can't feed the hungry if you can't feed yourself. You're not going to heal the sick if you're so sick you can't get out of bed to go pray for them. Right? You're not going to give good news to somebody if you think it's half bad news. If the church ever steps into its identity, we'll be walking healthy. We'll live long and prosper. Nanu, nanu, or something. I don't know. You know what I mean? The problem, yeah, thanks, Mike. The problem is we're spending all of our time dealing with us. If we're going to spend time with us, let's spend time teaching who we are, our identity, what we are, what we can do, what we can expect. Let's encourage the church. Instead of spending the last 2,000 years beating them up and telling them they need to get back to the altar and pray through and everything, that's why you're not getting healed. That's why you haven't your finances haven't been taken care of. That's why your relationships are all screwed up. Start telling them. You got it. You are it. You not only have it, you are it. Philippians 2:13 again. Now remember, he's talking about in Revelation there, he's talking about you come into the throne as I came into my Father's throne. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God has made unto us wisdom, righteousness, and sanctification and redemption. That's what they're talking about. You and I have become the throne room of God. You say, well, that doesn't make sense. Of course it does, because whatever you bind, I bind. Whatever you loose, I loose.
Yes.
We are seated with him in heavenly places. Out of us, God declares. That's the throne room. That's from where you make your declarations as a king. And they have to be carried out. Praise God. Okay, 1 John chapter 4, verse 4. And this is what John's talking about, right? What I just quoted or read from Ephesians. Ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Praise God. If you're of God, you can expect to act like God. It's not blasphemy. That's what Jesus said, and they wanted to crucify him for it. They called him a blasphemer when he was just simply saying the truth. For what are you going to kill me? For telling you the truth? I and my Father are one. Oh, they freaked out. I only do what my Father does. I only say what my Father says. That's us. That's us. That's us. If you're of God, you can expect to act like God. You can say stuff and it'll happen. You can curse cancers and they'll go. You can speak to your finances and you'll prosper. I don't care what your experience has been. I don't care what somebody else's experience has been. If you ever understand this, you'll never lack again. You'll have a life that is abundant life, and that more abundantly. Grace upon grace. And we're still dinking around out here in the outer court wanting to kill it, make another sacrifice, amen, or else drag our bloody carcass into the other room and just pray for another 10 hours, amen, and maybe something will happen, amen, or just read superficially the Bible again and just quote the same old stuff that we've always already heard and never really believed. It's artificial light. It's not revelation. If the Jews had revelation, they would have known God. That's what every revelation that had ever been given to them was for. They had an artificial light. It was better than no light, but it wasn't the light. And we have the light that lights the world, that brings revelation to everybody, but it has to shine out of us. Let your little light shine. You know, we miss the point. We make little nursery rhymes out of it, but if we walk in who we are, believe me, the light of God's going to shine. It shined everywhere Jesus went. Praise God. You can act like God. You can speak like God. You can dominate like God. You can rule like God. Sickness, disease, poverty, demons have to respond to you as if you were God. That's what Jesus tells us when he sends us out. In my name, cast out demons. Take any deadly thing, it's not going to hurt you. They could not take Jesus' life. He had to give it. No man takes my life, he said. I'm offering it. And no devil in hell can take you out of here prematurely. God's got a purpose for your life, and if you understand that, you'll keep declaring it until that purpose is finished. And then you'll be happy to just sit down and say, I'm ready to go. But not before my time. Not according to the devil's schedule. I'm going by God's calendar. As your days will be, so shall your strength. We ought to be saying that. You may not say that now because you're 30. Give me 20 years. Believe me, you'll be quoting it. You'll have it on your bathroom mirror, praise the Lord. But it's the truth. If it worked for Moses, it'll work for us. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's just looking for someone who will believe his report. Somebody that'll say, this day, this scripture is fulfilled in me. Praise God. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Who's in the world opposing God? Satan, who comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy. Who brings poverty, who brings sickness, who breaks up relationships. Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. But my God shall supply all your needs. Everybody say all. According to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Nobody knows the limits or the possibilities of the sons of God, because the sons of God have never operated limitlessly. We've always limited ourselves to our flesh. We've tried to make the flesh as good as possible to take some of the limits off or expand the boundaries, but we still have the limits. But that scripture tells me that there are no limits. There are no boundaries to the son or daughter of God. You are as God in this world. Jesus is your older brother. God in the flesh. That's how God sees you. My God supplies all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. The he that's in the world is Satan. The he that's in us is God. He's greater. He's the greatest. Therefore, we have limitless possibilities. Nothing is impossible to them that believe. Not to them that have a lot of faith. If you've got Jesus, you've got all the faith you need. You just need to believe what he's already told you. We spend so much time trying to develop faith. Why? We don't need faith. We have Christ. He has been made our faith. I just need to believe what he's already done. The church has been governed by sense knowledge, by philosophy. And we've called it religion. And all religion is just another philosophy. A way to live life. Hopefully a productive way. And it might be according to sense knowledge. But according to the Spirit, it's counterproductive. It literally works against what the Word of God is telling us. It focuses on us. It makes us aware of our flesh all the time. Good, bad, indifferent. You know, when I'm up, when I'm down, how much I prayed, you know, what, you know, stupid thing I said or thought or whatever. Please, somebody come pray for me. I'm all messed up. Well, guess what? So are they. No matter what your opinion of them is, no matter how much they've been on TV or how big a church they pastor, believe they're still messed up. They're not Jesus. You are. You make them not Jesus by going to them. You make them a better believer. That's why James says, call for the elders of the church. Peter says, you don't even have to call for anybody. You're already healed. I'm not saying be disrespectful to people that are doing things for God. I'm not against that. I'm just saying the reason why we are still limited is because we're still focusing on limits. We're focusing on people who are limited instead of the God that's in us. If you knew that no word of God was void of power, every time you opened your mouth, there'd be something that agreed with God's word. Yeah. Wouldn't you? I mean, if we really knew that, that no word here is void of power, then every time I'm confronted with anything negative or any lack or anything else, I want to say what that word says, because it has power. I said here a couple weeks ago about, you know, not liking hospitals and going, I go there, but I don't like them. They're negative. I mean, I know you don't have any choice. If somebody's there, you want to go see them, you've got to deal with that, you know. But sometimes I've been accused of being unsympathetic. That is true. It's not that I don't have compassion. I'm just not a real sympathetic person. My wife will be the first one to tell you. Cold-blooded snake. Now, well, she may say that, but not here. Praise the Lord. I just learned over the years, feeling sorry does not change anything. I mean, I learned something early on in the Marine Corps. Sorry won't feed the Admiral's cat. Praise the Lord. I mean, I understand compassion, but being sorry, what good is that? I just feel bad. Do you feel any better? No. You still got whatever it was you got. We need to not be so sorry as we are bold to declare the truth. You think about Smith Wigglesworth and some of these guys. That's not very sympathetic to grab some old woman out of a wheelchair and yank her up onto the platform and tell her to walk and she flops on the floor, and then pick her back up and say, walk, and she flops on the floor. There's several accounts of this kind of thing happening with him and others who were used in the healing ministry. Remember, this is 100 years ago. They don't have everything we got. We think we want to go back to that. But what I'm saying was, he had more compassion than anybody else in that room because he wanted her healed at any cost. They were sympathetic. They had sympathy for her. In fact, they threatened to beat him and run him out of town in one place because he just wouldn't give up. You cruel, you beast. You want her to walk? Or do you just want to sympathize with her in her wheelchair? He believed she'd walk if a demand was placed on the Spirit of God. If the word was spoken in faith and belief, you know. Amen. Let's look at this, Isaiah 55:11, and we'll wrap up with this. I'm not saying sympathy is not, you know, is evil or anything else. I'm just saying this is me. I've felt bad about people, and it didn't change a thing. I felt really bad in some situations, family and different. It didn't change anything. Feeling bad didn't bring them back. Feeling bad didn't raise them up. Feeling bad just doesn't get it. It's believing good that will change things. It's declaring. I'm not saying don't be compassionate, be cruel or heartless. I'm just saying, just crying on somebody's shoulder with them, you're just doubling up the negativity. Give them hope. Give them something to believe. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it will accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereunto I send it. He said it's like the rain and the snow that comes down. My word that goeth forth out of my mouth, it shall not return unto me void. When it leaves God's mouth, it's accomplished. The void is here. In other words, if I don't speak it in agreement with what God has said, there's a void there. There's an empty where there ought to be a full. No word of God is void of power. When it leaves God's mouth, it is done. It is finished. It's forever settled in heaven. The question is, will the void be filled on earth? And the only way that happens is when we declare it back with the same kind of attitude that it left heaven. Yep. This thing is done. It's got to be done because God said it.
Yep.
It's not based on how I feel about it. My faith, it goes crazy with what every feeling that I have. But I can believe things that I can't explain. I can't faith into reality. I mean, think about it. Can you figure out salvation? I mean, you know, the personal side of this thing, the reality of it. I don't have faith enough for that to believe. You know what I mean? But I believe it because it says it here. That makes it simple. I don't have to have great faith. I just got to be able to read. Or be able to hear somebody else read it. Or be able to read Braille or something. It doesn't have anything to do with what I feel like. It doesn't make sense. I can't get around this thing mentally because, you know, so many people die of cancer. And I don't deserve to be healed. Or this person doesn't deserve to be healed. Or, you know, whatever. I don't need to then conjure up enough faith to overcome all my doubts and my questions. I just got to believe, just simply believe what it says. Senses are out of the picture. You understand? That's why we're talking about. That's the big difference between the James call for the elders and Peter saying, "By his stripes you're healed." Talking to believers, they're all believers. Some are still operating in faith, their own faith, where others have settled it in the faith of Jesus. You don't need faith. You just need wisdom. And he has been made wisdom for us. So we need to get over our fears. We need to fearlessly take our place. Nothing is impossible to him that believes. That is the miracle realm. And it's not somewhere else. It's right here. Now, you just need to be a daredevil. Amen? Dare to live there. Dare to live in the miraculous realm. Enjoy your inheritance. Every day. I don't know what you want. I don't know what you need. But you do. And God does. And God's already said, it's yours.
Yep.
I've already told you, whatever you set your hand to prospers. Now, I just don't want to see a void there. Fill the voids. Say it back. And walk as though you already have it. Not, oh God, I hope my faith doesn't. My faith will waver if I get another bill. My faith will waver if the doctor's report comes. Forget that. Just believe. That's just sense knowledge. Anybody that's ever been healed, anybody that had a miracle, will tell you their senses were telling them something other than what their spirit was telling them. Amen? Anybody ever, I mean, when you start declaring what God has said, it feels like faith, I guess. Something rises up. It's just an assurance. It's just a sense that it's done. Even though nothing has changed. You didn't get a phone call yet. You didn't get the thing in the mail. You didn't get a knock on the door. It's just, I believe. And because I believe, it's done. It's already done. Amen? This is not complicated. We make it complicated. Say it's just that just sounds stupid. Well, I would just say it's uncomplicated.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. I'm not ignorant. I'm just uncomplicated. Praise the Lord. Amen. We say we just do this.
Yes.
Do you know this is the answer to every revival? Personal and collective. This is the answer to church growth. Not that we're just necessarily worrying about church growth, but we do a lot of stuff for church growth. But you see, when we do this, all the things get added. It's natural. People are healed. People are healthy. People are whole. People are prospering. Other people are attracted to that, especially if they're not healed, especially if they're not financially secure, especially if they're under a big burden of religious guilt and shame. And this works everywhere. This works in Africa. This works in South America. This works in Des Moines, Iowa. It'll work in London. It'll work anywhere because it's God. Instead of trying to get people into a denomination or into a sect or a religious way, a philosophy, just let's get them to God. Just get them to Jesus. But if we're hanging around somewhere outside the palace, directing everybody to the throne, and we don't know the way, people get nervous. And they start offering more sacrifices, praying longer, reading more Bible that they never understood in the first place. Nothing wrong with reading the Bible. Nothing wrong with praying. Nothing wrong with even making sacrifices, personal sacrifices between you and God that has nothing to do with your, with His grace and His mercy, but just something you decide, this is what I think. I just don't want to do that anymore. I don't. That's not helpful in my life, so I'm not going to do it. You understand what I'm saying? But not turn it into a barrier now that everybody else has to reach and meet just because of your own personal issues. This is personal between you and God. If God ain't, if God's not upset with it, don't let it bother you. You know? It's like your spouse. If God's happy, everybody's happy. Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's give Him a hand clap. Praise God. Amen. So let's just enjoy this abundant life and walk in it. Speak from God's perspective, because that's who you are. You can act like Him. You can talk like Him. You can do what He does. That's what He's given us. That's what He's provided for us. Amen. God bless you all. Have a great week. You're dismissed in the name of the Lord.